Welcome to the statistics class, the randomized block design, which represents an enhancement of one-way simple analysis of variance. And today I would like to exactly derive a formula for you for one of the error components. Actually, I haven't seen any postings on the YouTube and the internet where they exactly derive logically a formula for the SSE for the blocks. For you, and I will also explain you an improvement process of introducing blocks. As you remember, in the one-way analysis of variance, our data was organized in a two-dimensional array. In general, it was a rugged array. It was one-way driving factor, one attribute, one independent input variable. We called it treatment. In the randomized block design, the author of this methodology, Sir Fisher, he introduced blocks, which is the second attribute of the data, kind of second independent variable of the data. Sometimes it's called the two-way analysis of variance without interaction. As you know, in the two-way analysis of variance, we'll look at the two independent driving factors and their interaction effect. So in this case, we'll use only two grouping variables, the treatments and the blocks, no interaction between them. Since we introduce blocks for the rows, so I'll have my I variable, which runs from 1 to n. Since I have blocks, there is no point of using rugged array. We want to analyze data evenly. And in this case, when we introduce blocks, we'll have exactly rectangular shape. T treatments, variable j from 1 to t, the columns of the treatments, and the rows will represent blocks. The variable I runs from 1 to n, n blocks. For example, why do we need to introduce blocks? If you just look at the treatments, some of the data values within the same treatment may overrepresent the typical values situations or may underrepresent them. For example, when we test different brands of headlamps, headlights for the cars, and you give the same headlight to different drivers, you measure the reading. The distances where they can see the signs, and if you measure those readings from drivers of different age groups, naturally we know that our vision deteriorates with age. It's a natural process. So younger drivers tend to see the signs on longer distances. Older drivers will see the signs on the shorter distances. So in this case, we'll have kind of larger spread, larger variance. And our testing process may not be as exact when we introduce blocks. So in this case, the blocks would represent different age groups. So younger age group, middle age group, older age group. Also, in the drug development research, different age groups may react differently to different drugs. Another example of intrusive blocks could be when we test, let's say, metal sheets, the number of flexes when it breaks down, before it breaks down. You know, metal has fatigue, and the same alloy type, but if it's a brand new metal sheet, may have more flex before it breaks down. If it's old metal sheet, may not have as many flexes before it breaks down. So we may introduce blocks for the years of exploitation of the metal sheet, and so on. It's like a second attribute variable. In the same way, we calculate averages for the blocks. And we have averages for the treatments. And we use our error components. We discussed in one-way analysis of variance, SST, sum of squares for the total error, SSTR, sum of squares for the treatments, and SSE, sum of squares for the sample errors. And we use them in hypothesis testing process. We also know that there are two types of errors, type 1 error with probability alpha, say, and type 2 error with probability of beta. Those are false alarm errors or false positive results in drug research, false negative results. And when we introduce blocks, we will be able to kind of decrease those probabilities, which means we will improve our hypothesis testing strategy. I will also show you how we actually improve that strategy in this case. As you remember, SSTR is given by the formula we discussed before. NJ was the number of the elements in each treatment. Since we have a rectangular array, the number of the elements in each treatment is the same. It's n, the number of the blocks is n. So n will not have an index, it will be just n constant. I'll pull it out, common factor, factor it outside of the sum. And SSTR for the blocks will have this form, m multiplied by summation. Yeah? This is known to you. The same way we'll introduce SSB, sum of squares for the blocks, where I take the differences between the averages for the blocks compared to the grand average. Those will be shown in red. Those are the averages for the blocks. Compare them to the grand average. I take those differences, square them, multiply by t. Why? Each time I replace the item in my block with its corresponding average for that block. How many times? 1, 2, 3, up to t times. So x1 dot bar compared to the grand average for the x11. Then x1 dot bar compared to the grand average for the x12. And so on, t times. That's why I have t factor here. And SST, nothing new. Exactly the same formula, double summation. Sum of squares for the total error. In many books, many sources, they say SSE for the blocks will be the last component, which is equal to the total minus the differences of all the components calculated. It's a shortcut formula. And in many YouTube postings, this is what you do, guys. You calculate all those components separately, you take the real data, calculate those components, and you say then SSE will be equal to the difference SST minus all the components. Some of the books, not many books, give the exact formula. Again, that was a shortcut formula. And the exact formula is given here. And they do not really derive it for you. And I haven't seen any postings where you exactly derive that formula. And this is what I would like to derive this formula for you. Show the improvement process and exactly verify that SST is equal to the sum of the three components in this case. The treatments, the blocks, and the sampling error for the blocks. Let me start. As you remember, SST, sum of squares for the total, is equal to SSTR plus SSE, no blocks. We discussed it in the simple one-way analysis of variance. And we remember the formula. SSE, no blocks, was equal to the double summation, I runs from 1 to nj, Well, in this case, we'll just n node j index, the same number of the elements in each treatment, and j runs from 1 to t, x ij minus x dot j bar squared. Yeah? That was the formula for the SSE node blocks. The SSE for the blocks is given here. So I need to have the averages for the blocks and the grand averages in my formula. I don't have them here. And we all know the simple algebraic trick. If we need to use those values in there, we will add them up and subtract some value to preserve the result. You know that. So this is what I will do. Double sum, I runs from 1 to n, j runs from 1 to t, x I j minus x dot j bar. Also, I can kind of regroup those terms this way. I j minus x dot j bar minus x bar I dot minus x double bar this way, and square the double under the double summation, yeah? So here I'm comparing two errors and see how close they are to each other. Xij minus x dot j, that is it's each individual element in the treatment compared to its corresponding average for the treatment. This type of error minus the one in red. I dot bar minus x double bar, yeah? And I see how those errors are closer to each other. So in this double sum, I will just add this term x I dot bar minus x double bar, and I will subtract the same term, x I dot bar minus x double bar square, yeah? As you can see, I've added and subtracted the same value. So the result is preserved. I can use equality here. Yeah, nothing's changed. Equal the double sum. I runs from 1 to n, j 1 to t. Let me regroup it this way. X I dot bar minus x double bar plus x I j minus x dot j bar minus x I dot bar plus x double bar squared. Yeah? That's the square of the sum if you group your elements this way. Simple algebra formula, all know it. Square perfect square formula, which is equal to the square of the first term under the double summation, yeah? I from 1 to n, j from 1 to t, the square of x I dot bar minus x double bar plus the double sum of the square of the second term, I 1 to n, j 1 to t, x I j minus x dot j bar minus x I dot bar plus x double bar square, yeah, and plus twice their product, plus twice their product, double sum. See, I can split, regroup my double sums this way. Split them into three components of the double sums. I runs from 1 to n, j runs from 1 to t, twice the product of those two terms, x I dot bar minus x double bar, x I j minus x dot j bar minus x I dot bar plus x double bar. Yeah? Equal let me analyze all those three components separately. I will start with the double sum, twice the product of the double sum. Yeah? Let me look at this separately. So, twice the double sum, I1 to mj from 1 to t. As you can see, this term depends on the I variable only, of inner sum and outer sum here. So in this case, I can interchange, regroup my sums, so I can interchange them this way, and I will use my j index sum inside. So this is, let me show that here. Again, I will rewrite this twice the double sum product, x dot j bar minus x I dot bar plus x double bar. I can rewrite it this way. 2 by the sum, index I from 1 to n, x I dot bar minus x double bar. Yeah? By the sum, j from 1 to t, what's inside? X I j minus x dot j bar minus x I dot bar plus x double bar. Yeah? And again, this term was here. It does not depend on the j index. I can pull it up front, outside of the summation, and use it with the outer sum, with the I index. It's equal to sum I runs from 1 to n x I dot bar minus x double bar. Now let me analyze this summation. The first term, I have x I j, my I's fixed, j changes. So it's x I 1 plus x I 2, x I 1 plus x I 2 plus x I 3, and so on, plus x I t. Yeah? So when I extend the sum, I will be adding this element to itself how many times? From 1 to t. 1, 2, up to t times. The first index is fixed. I is fixed. The second index changes. What is that? It means that I'm moving within the row. I'm moving within the row. The first index is 1, 1, 1, 1, fixed, or 3, 3, 3, 3, fixed. Yeah? It's the sum of the elements within the same block, different treatments. What is it equal to? We know it's related to the average of the block, which is the sum of the elements of the block divided by t in this case. Yeah? So when I divide it by t, it will be equal to x I dot bar. Yeah? It will be equal to the average of the block I. So it means that the sum is equal to the average of the block I multiplied by t. Yeah? When I extend the sum, I will get the following. It's product here. It will be t by x I dot bar. I hope that's clear, yeah? X I dot bar. That's for this term. And exactly look at this term. It does not depend on J, only I dot bar under the J summation T times. Does not depend on the J variable. So it will be minus xi dot bar minus x I dot bar minus x I dot bar t times. So it's equal to minus t x I dot bar. So I just extended those two, the first and the third term of the sum. And the other two will keep them under the sum, which is equal to plus the sum j from 1 to t x double bar minus x dot j bar. What is that? If you look at this carefully, the grand average x double bar represents the average of the averages for the treatments, or it's the average of the averages for the blocks. It is easy to show that. We discussed that. In other words, the grand average is the sum of all the averages for the blocks divided by n, or it is the sum of all the averages for the treatments divided by t. Yes? So in other words, x double bar is the averages of all of those averages. And we all know the property, very important property of the average value. The sum of the differences, the sum of the distances from each point of the data set and its average is equal to zero. It is easy to show it, it is easy to prove it, and we all know that. Again, if you have a data set values and the average of the data set, then the sum of all the differences between each element of the data set and the average of the data set is equal to zero. So which means that this sum is zero. And obviously, those two values cancel out. T I dot bar minus T X I dot bar. Yes. Also zero. Zero. So everything inside is zero, which is my zero, is being multiplied by this difference under the I loop. All zeros. So everything is zero. And that's actually the same average property is here. So this term, all term, is actually zero. So this double term disappears. This double term is equal to zero. This double term, all term is zero. So in other words, if I continue my transformation here, the first component double sum, this one, represents this difference. We have only I index under the inner sum, and the inner sum is under the outer sum with the j index t times. There is no j index here. It means that this summation will be added to itself t times. In other words, I can write a t multiplied by the sum I from 1 to m x I dot bar minus x double bar squared. Yes? What is that? If you look carefully, this is exactly SSB. So I just found out, filtered out the SSB component from my SSE no blocks component. So before introducing blocks, once we introduce blocks, this component pops up as the SSB component. And the rest is done, actually. Yeah. This double summation is exactly SSE for the blocks. So I from 1 to m, xij minus x dot j bar minus x I dot bar plus x double bar squared. Yeah. Well, it's equal to, this is exactly my SSB And again, you can see that this is SSB, yeah, plus, and that is the formula, this double summation is the formula for the SSE for the blocks, which is offered in many sources. So this is SSE for the blocks. So in other words, thus we can say that SSE for the blocks indeed is equally the double summation I from 1 to n, j from 1 to t, xij minus x dot j bar minus xi dot bar plus x double bar squared. I just proved it. I just derived this formula for you. And again, I haven't seen any postings on the YouTube and the internet really, where they derive this formula for you. All of you guys, you just calculate those components, take the real values. You calculate the components and just show that the sum of those components is equal to SST. Yes, exactly. This is what we have exactly here. Since I started from SST, which was equal to SSTR plus SSE, no blocks. We explained it, derived it before, and once you introduce blocks, it will be equal to SSTR plus SSE no blocks. I started here, equal all the way, SSE no blocks, splits out into those two components, SSB plus SSE for the blocks. And I just prove this simple formula for you also. QED1, QED2. Those are two major outcomes of the randomized block design. The analysis of variance, sometimes called the two-way analysis of variance without interaction. Now you know how to derive a formula SSE for the blocks. And next important thing, the improvement of this process. If you carefully look at this sum, which is equal to SSE no blocks, yeah? I started out from here, SSE no blocks is equal to the sum of those two. And obviously those are non-negative, zero or more positive, let's say, values. Then what kind of relationship we have here? SSE for the blocks and SSE no blocks. It's obvious that SSE no blocks is larger than SSE for the blocks, more than or equal to. This is a great result. It's an improvement of our hypothesis testing technique. Improvement. Why? So once we introduce blocks, second attribute of the data, we can kind of control the SSB value, sum of squares for the blocks, which is a part of SSE, and the smaller part of the sum of squares for the sampling randomized error blocks, which is smaller. What does it mean? It means that our hypothesis testing strategy our test statistic is stronger in this case. The spread is smaller, we have more precise measurements, the test statistic is stronger, and our type 1 and 2 type error probabilities get smaller in this case, which means that our decision will be better, more precise in this case. We will have less false alarm, false positives, false negative results. We'll have less errors in the case of introducing blocks. And again, the block is a new attribute of the data, new grouping criteria, which helps us to reduce the error to improve our hypothesis testing strategy. I hope that was clear, interesting, and informative. And I also hope you definitely enjoyed that. Thank you very much. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.